Hello, everyone. I'm Aaron Wanjala, and I'm very excited to be here at I/O talking to you. I'm a Java developer advocate here at Google Cloud, but before joining Google, I spent several years as a dev building, shipping, and maintaining Spring and Angular apps. As a Java developer advocate, it's my job to sit between Google Cloud and you, the Java dev community, in order to help our products to be as useful as possible to you. That could mean coming to conferences and doing workshops like this, contributing to projects directly, or just hearing you folks out and bringing your feedback to product teams. That's why I'm excited to be here. I get to share what I hope is some useful information with you, and most importantly, invite you to start a conversation. So if you have any feedback on this workshop or Google Cloud's projects in general, I'm available on Twitter, DMs are open, feel free to reach out. In today's workshop, we'll be focusing on the Spring Native project. We'll start by explaining what it is and talking about some of its recent milestones. After that, we'll go over some good use cases for Spring Native apps, and finally, we'll work through implementing it together. So, without further ado, what is Spring Native? Simply put, Spring Native is a project to make it easier for developers to compile their Spring applications into native executables. Running your applications as native executables rather than on the JVM means smaller artifacts, faster startup times, and lower memory usage, all of which allows you to get more work done with the resources that you already have. We'll get into the details of why that is in just a moment. Spring Native makes use of several concepts and technologies to make this happen, including ahead-of-time compilation and GraalVM. We'll talk a bit about these before we actually start using Spring Native. Currently, the project is in an experimental phase and is separate from the main Spring and Spring Boot projects, and I know that could make you pause when thinking about implementing it in a larger project. I've been there, but Spring Native has been an especially promising project, which is probably why at Spring 1 2021, it was announced that it would be merged into Spring Boot 3.0 and have first-class support. With that announcement in mind, I think now is a perfect time to take a closer look at the project and think about how it can help us run our workloads more efficiently. Okay, let's discuss compilation. The first thing we should discuss are the differences between Java's standard just-in-time compilation and the ahead-of-time compilation that we'll be ending with today. When developers run Java C normally at compile time, we turn our .java source code into .class bytecode. These class files can only really be understood by the Java virtual machine itself, so before our code can actually be executed on our server at runtime, the JVM must interpret or further compile it into native code just in time for it to be executed at runtime. This approach has one big advantage and one big drawback. On the one hand, we get to write our code once and run it everywhere, the popular Java tagline, and that gives us portability because we know that the JVM will figure out how to execute it on whichever system we end up deploying it to. On the other hand, the interpretation step is quite expensive when compared to just running native code directly. As a result, we often end up trading performance for portability, even in situations where that portability doesn't buy us all that much. Ahead-of-time compilation takes the opposite approach by compiling all reachable code into a native executable at compile time so that we can simply run our code on the target machine. The result here is a trade-off in the opposite direction, giving up portability in exchange for a smaller application that executes our code directly at runtime without the need for further compilation, meaning that your app can start up faster and uses less memory. Of course, each approach can shine in their own use cases. The standard JVM is very well optimized for long-running processes, while AOT compilation is great for short-lived workloads where a fast startup time is important. As a fun fact, AOT compilation was introduced as an experimental feature in JDK 9. Though its implementation was expensive to maintain and never quite caught on, so it was quietly removed in Java 17 in favor of developers just using GraalVM, which is what Spring Native makes use of. Speaking of GraalVM, what exactly is it? GraalVM is a highly optimized open source JDK distribution that boasts extremely fast startup times, AOT native compilation, and polyglot capabilities that allow developers to mix multiple languages into a single application. Graal is in active development with lots of notable milestones, but the one I'll quickly highlight here is Java 17 support, which is pretty recent, having only happened on January 18th, 2022. So to be a little bit more specific with our earlier Spring Native definition, Spring Native enables the use of GraalVM's native image compiler to turn Spring applications into native executables. This process involves performing a static analysis of your application at compile time to find all methods and configuration in your application that are reachable from the entry point. This essentially creates a closed-world conception of your application, where all code is assumed to be known at compile time, and no new code is allowed to be loaded at runtime. It's important to note that native image generation is a memory-intensive process that takes longer than compiling a regular application, and imposes limitations on certain aspects of Java. In some cases, no actual code changes are required for an application to work with Spring Native. However, there are some things like dynamic class loading or dynamic proxies that need to be enumerated or configured ahead of time in order to work. In those situations, Spring Native provides things like native hints to simplify the process, which are well documented. All right, with all that background covered, we can finally write some code. Before we start implementing Spring Native, we'll need to create and deploy an app to establish a performance baseline that we can compare to the native version later. Today, we'll be going through this on the Cloud Shell on a new Google Cloud project to minimize the configuration required, but you can follow along on your own machine as well. We'll start by getting our app from start.spring.io. The starter app uses Spring Boot 2.6.4, which is the latest version that's supported by the Spring Native project at time of writing. Note that since the release of GraalVM 21.0.3, you could use Java 17 for the sample as well. We will be sticking with Java 11 today to minimize the config involved, though. Once we have our zip on the command line, we can create a subdirectory for our project and unzip the folder in there. Once we have the project open in our IDE of choice, I'll be using Cloud Editor, we'll quickly add a sign of life and something to showcase the Spring Native performance once we run it. One quick tip for others using Cloud Code, I find that I get better code completion and import suggestions when I first open my source directory as a workspace. All we're doing here is adding two fields, start time and ready time, to help us understand the startup time once we run our application, instructing the main function to save the start time, then using the application ready event to log when Spring says our application is ready. Once we have those two times, we're ready to take the duration between them and display the startup time when a user visits our app. At this point, our baseline app is ready to go. So feel free to build an image and run it locally in order to get an idea of the startup time before we convert it to a native application. To build our image, we can run the Spring Boot build image Maven goal. Once that's built, you can also use something like Dive or Docker Images Demo to get an idea of the size of the baseline image. And if we want to run our locally built regular Docker image, we can do so with Docker Run. Now that we have our app, we'll deploy it and take note of the startup times, which we'll compare to our native app startup times later on. Depending on the type of application you're building, there are several options for hosting your stuff. However, since our example is a very simple, straightforward web application, we can keep things really simple and just rely on Cloud Run. If you're following along on your own machine, make sure to have the gcloud CLI tool installed and updated. Since this project is still in the experimental phase, we'll have to configure our app to be able to find experimental artifacts, which are not available in Maven's central repository. This will involve making changes to our POM, which you can do in the editor of your choice. Next, we'll need to bring in the dependencies required to run a Spring application as a native image. Note that this step is not necessary if you're using Gradle. Now we'll add the ahead of time plugin to improve native image compatibility and artifact footprint. And now we'll update Spring Boot Maven plugin to enable native image support and use the Paketo builder to build our native image. Note that the tiny builder image is just one of several options. It's a good choice for our use case because it has very few extra libraries and utilities, which helps us to minimize our attack surface. But if, for example, you were building an app that needed access to some common C libraries, or you weren't yet sure of your app's requirements, then the full builder might be a better fit. Okay, now that our app's all configured, we should be able to build our image and run our native compiled app. Before running the build, here are a few things to keep in mind. This will take more time than a regular build. Think a few minutes. This build process can take a lot of memory, think a few gigabytes. This build process requires the Docker daemon to be reachable. And while in this example, we're going through the process to manually build, you can also configure your build phases to automatically trigger a native build profile. With that in mind, just like before, we can build our app with the Spring Boot build image goal. And once that's built, we can run it the same way. At this point, we're in a great position to see both sides of the native application equation. We've given up a bit of time and extra memory usage at compile time, But in exchange, we get an application that can start up far more quickly and consume significantly less memory, depending on the workload. If we run something like Dive or Docker Images Demo to compare the size of the native image to the original, we can see a dramatic reduction in the image's size. We should also note that in more complex use cases, there are additional modifications needed to inform the AOT compiler of what your app will do at runtime. For that reason, certain predictable workloads like batch jobs may be very well suited to this, while others could be a bigger lift. In order to deploy our app to Cloud Run, we'll need to get our native image into an image store or package manager like Artifact Registry. We can get started on this by creating a repository. Then we'll need to make sure that we're authenticated to push images to our new registry. The gCloud CLI simplifies this process quite a bit. Now we'll tag our image. Finally, we can use Docker push to send it to Artifact Registry. We are now ready to take the native application image that we've stored in Artifact Registry and deploy it to Cloud Run. Since we've built and deployed our app as a native image, we can rest assured that our application is making excellent use of our infrastructure costs as it runs. And now that our native service is ready, we can compare its startup time to the original. Congratulations on building and deploying a Spring Native application on Google Cloud. Hopefully this tutorial encourages you to get more familiar with the Spring Native project and keep it in mind should it meet your needs in the future. Whether you created a new Google Cloud project for this workshop or are reusing an existing one, take care to avoid unnecessary charges from the resources we made use of.